In order to curb an economic problem, it is of utmost importance to identify, conceptualize, and measure it first. We have gathered here today to celebrate the very same spirit and the contributions of one exceptional man towards it. Welcome to the third Suresh Tendulkar Memorial Lecture. We would like to begin with a short movie to familiarize all of you with the essence of the Symbiosis family. Director, Symbiosis School of Economics and Dean, Faculty of Humanities and Social Sciences.
A very warm good morning to one and all. Amidst us, Dr. Vivek Debroy, the Tendulkar family, Professor Tutakne, directors, faculty, students, staff, a warm welcome to you to the third Professor Suresh Tendulkar Memorial Lecture. Today, Professor Vivek Debroy will be giving a lecture on 25 years of reforms, poverty and inequalities. About Symbiosis School of Economics, and then we come down how we have evolved over the years. In June 2008, when a group of faculty comprising of none other than Dr. Parchure, Mrs. Parchure, Dr. Gupte, our Vice Chancellor, Pradeep Apte, myself, and a couple of other colleagues put together a program structure for the BSc Economics, which has seen the light of the day, and today we have the ninth batch with us. In 2011, we put together the MSc program, offering two specializations, international trade and development studies, and from this year onwards, we have included urban development. Next year, we would be into our decennial celebrations, a long journey of hard work and moving ahead as a sapling that grows from the program to the core. To keep our program moving ahead, we have set up centers, and these centers are Center for Quality Learning and Application, Center for Academic Writing, a newly set up Center for Experimental and Behavioral Economics, and soon to be announced, the Symbiosis School of Economics Center for Urban Research. Our students, where have they gone? They've gone to IIM, Ahmedabad, Indore, IIT Mumbai to pursue their PhD, to do their masters. And over the years, we've had this great line of linkage in this western region of India with Gokhale Institution, with Mumbai University, with IGIDR, with TISS, RIS, with the Ministry of External Affairs, with Asia Europe Foundation, and how we have collaborated with them in many different ways. Going back to my students, and where have they been? They've done us proud. Some of them are, one of them is a consultant with the Finance Ministry, one of them is a consultant with UNDP, one of them is an Indian Economic Service officer, some of them have made it to great universities in US and, you know, Europe and Australia, be it where a three-year program has given them acceptance to a master's, generally where people need 4 years of education in India to make to such programs. They've also found their way to LSE and Warwick, St. Andrews, John Hopkins University, National University Singapore. These are just to name a few. And where are we headed towards? Well, the direction is right. We are moving in the right direction. We have great support and guidance from our various mentors. And today, we are into our third Professor Suresh Tendulkar Memorial Lecture. Something that was in my mind in 2014. And why Professor Suresh Tendulkar Memorial Lecture? Why him? He was, I heard, in 2010, moved back to Pune from Delhi. And we felt, well, we were just on that, in that period, planning our master's program. So I said, let it see the light of the day, and I will go and meet Professor Tendulkar personally and tell him that now that you're in Pune, please be our mentor, please be our guide, and help us through this journey. But before that could happen, we got the not so good news in June 11 that he was no more. By June 14, we realized we have established ourselves when I went to meet the Tendulkar family and they agreed to allow us to have this program. The best part of it was that when we instituted these lectures, I wrote, my first writing was to Subir Kokar, and instantly he said, I will come. The next was we thought of Mahindra Devji, and he says, he was my guru, this is the best tribute I can give. And recently in the month of April, I wrote a note to Professor De Broglie and said, you know, I'd like to come to meet you, sir, and I want to invite you to chair a session for a conference in May 2017, and if you could also deliver the Suresh Tendulkar Memorial Lecture. When I met him in person, he says, I am not going to come to chair any conference, but if you ask me to come to pay a tribute to an economist like Professor Suresh Tendulkar, I definitely will do that. That itself made me feel that we are on the right track and we are moving fine, because it's been so nice to be able to attract the greatest of great economists in India to come and deliver these lectures. Coming down to Professor Tendulkar, he studied at BMCC Bombay in Pune, done his master's from DSE, PhD from Harvard, taught at the Delhi Center of ISI, was later professor and head and director of the Department of Economics, Delhi School of Economics. He was the managing editor, Journal of Indian Economic Review, director at the Center of Development Economics, DSE. He was the member of the 1993 Expert Group on Estimation of Poverty, the fifth Central Pay Commission, he was a member of that too, and the first Disinvestment Commission. He was a part-time member of the National Statistical Commission, and he's been an active public policy maker during his phase, and had become the Prime Minister's was a part of the Prime Minister's Economic Advisory Council from 2004 to 2008, and then Chairman of the Prime Minister's Economic Advisory Council 2008-2009. In 2009, he was chairman of the expert group to review the methodology for estimation of poverty. His work on measurement and analysis of living standards in India, with a focus on inequality and poverty, remains his lasting legacy to public policy. But he has also authored a number of research papers on diverse topics, diverse themes, and two important books, namely Reintegrating India with the World Economy with T.N. Srinivasan and Understanding Reforms Post-1991 with T.A. Bhavani. The second Suresh Tendulkar Memorial Lecture delivered by Mahindra Dev sent us the following message. I'll read that message. It goes like this. My association with Professor Suresh Tendulkar dates back to 1978 when I joined the Delhi School of Economics as a doctoral student. He was one of my mentors during my days as a student and also during much of my lifetime after the school. His path-breaking work on poverty is well known. I learned a lot from my interaction with him for nearly 3.5 decades. In one of his last presentations, Professor Tendulkar stated, one can always look at the cup as being half empty or half full. I think even at the end of my short life, I still see the cup half full, and I'm quite optimistic that the younger generation which is coming will ensure that the cup is filled in due course of time. Take it forward and the India growth story will get completed. With these few words, I request dignitaries, Professor De Broglie, I'll invite Professor Rajas Parchure to please come up to light the lamp, to pay our tribute to Professor Tendulkar. And I also request our former Chancellor, Tutakle sir, to please come. Sir.
Thank you.
I would now request Dr. Jyoti Chandramani to felicitate our guest of honor, Dr. Vivek Dev Roy. Extend our appreciation and acknowledgement of the extreme efforts put in by two individuals, Ms. Ishita Ghosh and Ms. Sushma Nayak, as a part of the Center for Academic Writing in putting together the Student Journal of Symbiosis School of Economics this year. We can only imagine how many sleepless nights you must have spent to make the journal a success. We would like to take this opportunity to release the Student Journal, Economica Scriptus, for the academic year 2015-16 in the hands of our chief guest. I would request Ms. Ghosh and Ms. Nayak to please come up on stage. I would now request our chief guest, Dr. Vivek Dev Roy, to hand over a small gift to Ms. Ghosh and Ms. Nayak as tokens of our appreciation. Our speaker today, Dr. Vivek Dev Roy, has been an extremely versatile person. He has held teaching positions in institutes of repute like Presidency College, Kolkata, Gokhale Institute of Politics and Economics, Pune, Indian Institute of Foreign Trade, Delhi, to name a few. He has led the Ministry of Finance UNDP project on legal reforms and has worked with the Department of Economic Affairs, National Council of Applied Economic Research, Rajiv Gandhi Institute for Contemporary Studies, Center for Policy Research, again to name a few. He has authored, edited several books, reports, papers, and popular articles, and has also been a consulting and contributing editor with several newspapers. Apart from academic writing, he has translated the Bhagavad Gita and the Hindu epic, the Mahabharata. He has also authored many other books on Indian epics and mythology. He is a permanent member of the National Institution for Transforming India, Aayog, fondly known as the Niti Aayog. He has been awarded the Padma Shri in 2015 for his varied contribution to the country. Sir, we are extremely privileged to have you amidst us today. May I now request Sir to deliver his talk on 25 years of economic reforms, poverty and inequality.
Professor Suresh Tendulkar's family, faculty and students of Symbiosis, others from other research institutes in Pune, and all the other distinguished invitees. Let me begin by thanking Symbiosis for having invited me here today to deliver the third Professor Suresh Tendulkar Memorial Lecture. It's a matter of great honor to me that I've been asked to do this. Professor Suresh Tendulkar never actually taught me, because by the time I had left the Delhi School of Economics, he hadn't joined. But I had a close association with him down the years in his various responsibilities, whether it was the National Statistical Commission, whether it was the Prime Minister's Economic Advisory Council, whether it was the Pay Commission, and also something very, very minor in his illustrious career that was not mentioned, which is India Today had a board of economists, and both Professor Tendulkar and I were members of that. So I said, I'm honored, I'm delighted. As was mentioned in the introduction to Professor Tendulkar, he has worked on diverse areas. But all said and done, he is still remembered for his contribution to measurement of both poverty and inequality, and on policy measures designed to counter the problems of both poverty and inequality. What I therefore propose to do is to speak on what has been mentioned there, beginning with poverty and inequality, and then I will link it up to what we are now observing, namely the 25 years of Indian reforms defined as the reforms that were started in the year 1991. Let's begin with the issue of poverty. Poverty is a multi-dimensional, multifaceted issue which is difficult to pin down and measure. Traditionally, poverty measurements, have focused on trying to measure a certain minimum level of income which is required for basic subsistence. So if an individual is below that poverty line, defined in terms of a minimum consumption basket that is required for survival, that person or that household is poor. Those who are relatively young will not remember that much of the pioneering work on measuring poverty was done in this city. There was a famous study by Dandekar and Rath, and there was a heated debate at that point in time between Dandekar and Roth on one side and Professor Sukhatme on the other. Most of the younger generation will probably not know that the initial measurements of poverty, the debate, the concept of the poverty line started in India much, much before the World Bank began to measure poverty. It started towards the end of the 1950s, particularly in a journal known as Sankhya. So this entire issue of how do you measure poverty has a fairly long tradition in India. Most of the initial measurements of poverty tended to be in terms of pinning down the number of calories an individual needed to survive, suitably calibrated in accordance with age, rural urban status, the nature of work, so on and so forth. So conceptually, one has now established a poverty line. Having conceptually established the poverty line, one still needs data. How How do you get the data? You get the data through something called the National Sample Survey. The National Sample Survey, the NSS, undertakes surveys throughout the country, except that the really respectable samples, the so-called large samples, happen once every 5 years. They don't happen every year. And on the basis of the NSS surveys, you can now figure out what percentage of the population in any particular state is below that poverty line. Problem number one, as in many countries in the world, these household surveys that the NSS organizes and undertakes do not capture income. What they instead capture is consumption expenditure. So the so-called headcount ratio or poverty ratio in the Indian case is based on what percentage of the population has a per capita income per month below that poverty line. It's a measure of consumption poverty, not income poverty. Many economists have debated what this poverty line should be, and one of the things that Professor Tendulkar did is what was mentioned in the introduction, a refinement of the poverty line that the Historical Planning Commission had done in the 70s and its replacement by what is now called the Tendulkar poverty line on the basis of a workforce task force that Professor Tendulkar headed. What's the big picture story? The big picture story is something like the following. In the year 1950, the percentage of the Indian population that was below the poverty line, as I have just defined it, was around 50%. So in the year 1950, the percentage of the Indian population that was below the poverty line was 50%. In the year 1980, 30 years down the line, the percentage of the Indian population that was below the poverty line was still 50%. So roughly speaking, in 1950, it was 50%. Roughly speaking, in 1980, it continued to be 50%. Despite 3 decades of attempts to reduce poverty, the percentage of population below the poverty line had not significantly declined. What is the figure like today? If I ignore the debates about the poverty line and the disputes of the kind that I have mentioned, the big picture story is that it is roughly 20%. 50%, 50%, 20%. In terms of the analogy that was used, is the glass half full or half empty? If I look at the reduction, obviously the glass is half full. From 50% in 1980, today it is down to around 20%. 20% of the population in India is more than the populations of most countries in the world. So if I look at that absolute size of the poverty number, the glass is still largely half empty. But at least the reduction has begun, and the question to ask is, or one of the questions to ask is, Why has the reduction happened? And if we know the answer as to why the reduction has happened, then we can figure out what we need to do in future to ensure further reductions. But before that, let me mention an issue that is slightly technical in nature. Income distributions and consumption expenditure distributions are not symmetric distributions. They are not curves, bell-shaped curves like this. They tend to be positively skewed. So they are like that. If I'm going to be technical, they are what statisticians refer to as log normal. What is the implication of that? The implication of that is reductions in poverty are not linear, because whenever that thick part of that distribution passes above the poverty line, you have sharp reductions in poverty. This is exactly what happened in countries that went through rapid phases of economic growth. When you go through rapid phases of economic growth, because the thick part of the distribution passes above the poverty line, you have sharp, you have those sharp reductions in poverty. Extrapolated for India, what does it mean? Extrapolated for India, this means that by the year 2025, there is absolutely no reason why the percentage of the Indian population that is poor should not be around 10%. I mentioned the National Sample Survey. There is a difference between a survey and a census. A survey gives you an overall figure. A survey will never enable me to know whether Professor Rajesh Parchure's household is poor or rich. To know that, I need to have a census. One of the problems with the poverty numbers, as computed by the former Planning Commission on the basis of the NSS surveys, was I would never know which particular household was rich or poor. As I said, this can only be done through a census, not through a survey. Some of you may know that now there is such a census. There is such a census for both rural India and for urban India that is called the SECC. The SECC is a decentralized identification of poor households on the basis of their possession of various household characteristics. Essentially, what happens is that list of deprivation, if I'm going to use the example of villages, is put up in the Panchayat Bhavan. And so you can come and complain if your name has not been included. And you can also complain if my name has been included by mistake. After those errors of omission and commission have been taken care of, the SECC lists are finalized. And today, For all the government programs, increasingly, it is the SECC database that is being used. Let me make one more comment about poverty. I said poverty is a multidimensional concept. How on earth can we try and reduce it only to income poverty or consumption poverty, which, as I just explained, is the percentage of population that is below that particular poverty line? Many, many years ago, through the UNDP, the concept of a human development index surfaced. The HDI, broadly speaking, is based on three heads of indicators that seek to measure poverty. The first set, or the first head, is income poverty. The second set, or second head, is indicators linked to education. And the third set, or third head, is indicators linked through to health. So I've got income, I've got education, I've got health. I combine all of those together and I get what is called a HDI. The HDI started to be computed in the year 1990. And if you track India's performance since 1990 as measured by the HDI, again to use the half full glass, half empty glass analogy, if I look at India's rank vis-a-vis the other countries in the world, it is more like half empty because the rank is still fairly bad. By the way, there is a very strong correlation between India's rank among various countries on the HDI indicators and India's FIFA ranking. But if you look at the improvement down the years on the HDI scores, it is fairly obvious that India's HDI track record has been improving. It's been improving more because of the income side, and today it's improved less because of improvements in either education or health. Since I've mentioned the HDI, let me also quickly mention the MDGs. Most of you probably know that the MDGs had a three-tier structure. There were goals, there were targets, and there were indicators. The MDGs, in a sense, ended in the year 2015. And if you look at the performance of the world on MDGs, on the poverty part, the target was to halve the number of people who live in conditions of extreme poverty. The world as a whole has accomplished that task primarily because of China, where the growth track record has led to a sharp reduction in the number of Chinese citizens who are poor. The MDGs have now been taken over by the SDGs. For the SDGs, we only have the goals so far. We still have not finalized as a global community the targets, and we have not even begun to talk about the indicators. The target for the SDGs is the year 2030. If the world as a whole is going to be successful in accomplishing the SDG targets, a large part of that responsibility devolves on India. Because contribution to reducing poverty that will have the most impact in terms of the world adhering to the SDG targets of reducing poverty. So far, everything that I have said has been expressed in terms of India as a country, as an aggregate. All aggregates are misleading. All averages are misleading. If you catch hold of me, put one of my feet inside a fridge and the other one inside an oven, on an average, I will be very comfortable. There is a great deal of heterogeneity amongst India's states and amongst India's regions. I should quickly mention that although the UNDP brings out the Human Development Report, which is a comparison across countries, the UNDP in India has encouraged states to bring out state-level human development reports. And most states have brought out at least one version of a state-level human development report. There are states which have brought out more than one. And these state-level human development reports not only enable us to track whether a state has improved over time, they also enable us to track the significant variations across districts that can exist even within a state. How many districts does India have? Someone will say 600, someone will say 650, because the number keeps changing a little bit. So let's say 600. Out of those 600 districts, about 100 districts continue to be deprived whatever measure of poverty you choose to use. Whatever be the measure of poverty, about 100 out of India's 600 or 620 or 640 districts will be deprived. It is a shame that more than 65 years after independence, 100 of those districts continue to be deprived, whatever be the measure you choose to use. Often, these districts are contiguous geographically. They span a contiguous mass geographically, beginning actually with parts of Maharashtra, cutting across central India and towards the eastern parts. A long time ago, an expression was used and coined known as the Bimaru states. Bimaru was an acronym with a pun on the word Bimar, the acronym standing for Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan and Uttar Pradesh. Undivided Bihar, undivided Uttar Pradesh. It is true that several parts of those states still continue to be relatively deprived. But it is also true that some parts of West Bengal and some parts of Orissa are also fairly deprived. But more importantly, states are neat administrative boundaries, but there are significant variations within states. And the focus of policy attention and the focus of policy intervention needs to be on the kinds of districts that I mentioned which are deprived. Let me say the same thing slightly differently. There is a quote of Gandhiji's that people quote all the time. Gandhiji said, India lives in its villages. He didn't say, he wrote. Gandhiji wrote, India lives in its villages, and by implication, India also dies in its villages. Many people quote this without necessarily having read the passage. If you read the passage, you will find that a few sentences down from where he talks about India living in its villages, there is a precise number of the number of villages in India then when Gandhiji wrote. And the number of villages was 700,000. Over a period of time, villages disappear because of various reasons. They merge into urban agglomerations. They are reclassified. Some of them disappear because people no longer live there. Today we don't have 700,000 villages, we have 600,000 villages. Out of those 600,000 villages, around 150,000 villages still lack the kinds of things that you and I take for granted. They still lack roads, water, electricity, access to the dispute resolution system, primary health centers, education, skills, access to land markets, all of those. So the focus of any government's policy intervention needs to be to ensure that those deprived villages get those things that should have been ensured since the day India attained independence 47. Having said this about poverty, let me now move on to inequality. Poverty is an absolute concept. Poverty is a function of what is happening to me as an individual or to my household. Inequality is relative. Inequality is in comparison to someone else. There was a famous economist named Lord Keynes. Everyone has heard about Lord Keynes. Lord Keynes was once asked, "How is your wife?" And Lord Keynes responded saying, "Compared to whose wife?" All inequality comparisons are relative. The problem that really arises, how do we define inequality? How do we define the expression inclusion or inclusive growth? It is one thing to say that everyone should have, it is one thing to say that there should not be a great deal of disparity in incomes, which is an outcome actually, and it is a completely different thing to say that everyone should have equal access to inputs of the kinds that I mentioned, the judicial redressal system, land markets, health, education, information technology, other kinds of markets. In one case, we are talking about access. That's a bit like an input. In another case, we are talking about outcomes. To give an example, to dramatize it, it is one thing to say that every student should have equal access to getting admission into symbiosis. It is a completely different thing to say that every student should pass out of symbiosis with the same set of marks. In my personal view, what is important is to ensure that everyone has equal access. much the outcomes. In any case, if you look at whether the theoretical literature or the empirical literature, in any country that goes through a rapid phase of economic growth, there is an increase in inequality measured by outcomes. Since I gave you numbers on poverty, I should give you numbers on inequality also. The most common measure used to measure inequality in distribution of anything, income and consumption expenditure included, is something called the Gini coefficient. The Gini coefficient ranges between 0, which is perfect equality, and 1, which is perfect inequality. India's Gini coefficient is around 0.34 for urban India and around 0.32 for rural India. But remember what I said? We don't have data on income. We collect data on consumption expenditure, at least through the NSS. But data on income are collected by a different organization called the NCAER, the National Council for Applied Economic Research. If I go by the NCAER findings, the Gini coefficient in India is around 0.4. Is that a reason for worry? As a pure number, no. Because there are countries in the world where the Gini coefficient is around 0.6. So purely in terms of numbers, that's not a reason to worry. It is a reason to worry because as an individual, I worry less about inequality if I perceive that my absolute level of living is going up. So perceptions about inequality are really a dynamic process. If I perceive that growth is leading to improvements in my status, if I perceive that the lives of my sons and daughters are going to be better than my own lives, I worry a little bit less about what Vijay Mallya is doing. If I perceive that my life is not improving, I worry much, much more about what Vijay Mallya is doing. There was a book that was edited by Ishar Aluwalia in honor of Dr. Manmohan Singh. If I remember right, Rajesh will correct me if I don't remember right, that was 10 years after the reform. And in that book, there was a paper authored by Professor Suresh Tendulkar. In that paper, Professor Suresh Tendulkar recounts an anecdote when he was part of a delegation that had gone to China in the mid-1980s when Dr. Manmohan Singh was the deputy chairman of the Planning Commission. So this delegation had gone to China, Suresh Tendulkar was part of that, and Dr. Manmohan Singh as deputy chairman of the Planning Commission was part of that, and they were talking to the Chinese Minister for Planning. Remember, 84, 85. The Chinese minister explained what they were doing in the course of the reforms. And Dr. Manmohan Singh said, but if you do all of this, there will be an increase in inequality. To which the Chinese minister responded, we certainly hope so. Which underlines the point that I made earlier, that in any period of rapid growth, you are certain to have increases in inequality. Having said all of this, let us ask the following question. Why are people poor? Why is it the case that people are poor? It is my submission that no able-bodied person in the working age groups is voluntarily poor. Every able-bodied person in the working age groups wants to improve his or her life. Disabled people are different, old-aged people are different, infants, mothers with infant children, they are different, but in the working age groups, no one is voluntarily poor. People are poor because they have been deprived of the kinds of inputs that I mentioned. What is India's per capita income? India's per capita income in US dollars depends a little bit on the exchange rate, is let us say around 1600 US dollars. Around. Quite often, people travel abroad. They go and see what is happening in the developed countries in Western Europe, North America, and then they come back and say, why can't India be like that? What they forget is that it is an apples versus oranges comparison. It is not a fair comparison at all. India's per capita income, 1600 US dollars. The average per capita income of the countries we are making comparisons with, 50,000 US dollars. Comparisons are often made, sometimes made, between India today and the United States in the 1870s. What was the per capita income of the United States in the 1870s? Around 3,000 US dollars. What is the point I'm trying to make? The point I'm trying to make is a double one. A country with per capita income of 1600 US dollars will lack fiscal resources, and it will also lack administrative resources, administrative capacities. So in terms of governance, whatever be the definition of governance, it is completely unrealistic to expect that a country like India will be able to deliver the kind of governance that you see in the United States and Europe today. The comparison should not be with the United States and Europe today. The comparison should instead be with the United States, let us say, in the 1930s. But comparisons apart, prioritization. And to repeat what I said earlier in slightly different language, I personally think that if we can ensure for every citizen in the country access to law and order and the judicial system, roads, water, electricity, health and education, we will, as a government, do all that is necessary to enable people to improve their lives. If we expect the government to do 50 different things, it will do all of those 50 different things inefficient. If we can focus the government's attention on delivering just those items that I mentioned, law and order, security, roads, water, electricity, and health and education, that's all we need to do. As long as we can create an enabling environment, there is plenty of entrepreneurship in India, not just in the corporate sector. In fact, it is my view that most of entrepreneurship in India exists outside the corporate sector. What is entrepreneurship? It is risk-taking. The corporate sector doesn't take that many risks. The poor streetcar vendor who is constantly
harassed by the cops takes many more risks. The farmer takes many more risks. So if risk taking is the definition of entrepreneurship, there is a huge element of entrepreneurship that exists outside the corporate sector, which is what the Prime Minister means when he talks about private capital and private entrepreneurship. When he talks about Startup India, he does not mean Startup India, Stand Up India, in the sense in which the pink papers interpret it, which is IT and the financial sector. But I've digressed. So if as a government we can ensure that enabling environment and prioritize resources into delivering those items that I mentioned, I think in the next 10 years, 20 years, we will stop debating poverty and unemployment by that much, because we no longer need to measure poverty, because we will have made some kind of a dent on poverty. But while on resources, let me mention the following. How much does the union government and the state governments together, how much do they collect as taxes, as a share of GDP? The union government and state governments together collect about 17% of GDP as taxes. 17% of GDP collected as taxes. How much is spent on subsidies? When I'm using the word subsidies, I'm not talking only about explicit subsidies that come out of the budget. I'm not talking only about union government subsidies. I'm talking about state level subsidies also. Explicit as well as implicit, the off budget ones. I'm not only talking about consumption subsidies, I'm also talking about production subsidies. All together comes to 14% of 14% of GDP going as subsidies. Where do I have the resources to spend on law and order, security, roads, water, electricity? One of the conscious attempts of this particular government is to shift the focus towards delivery. I understand that Symbiosis has students from the Northeast, some students from the Northeast. You have no idea what it means, if nothing else for symbolic purposes, to a person from a state in the northeastern parts of the country where there is a railway line for the first time after independence in the state. You have no idea how important symbolically it has been that there will now be an airport finally in that state after so many years of independence. But the broad point I'm making is that prioritization of resources and the shift from doles towards empowerment. Two or three other points and then I'm going to stop. I mentioned the SECC database. I should quickly mention the Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana accounts. I'm not saying that all those accounts are clean, because there are multiple accounts, but at least half the accounts are clean, the others are being cleaned up. If those numbers are accurate, then at a sweeping level of generalization, we have solved the debate about financial inclusion defined in terms of people not having bank accounts. The debate now shifts to encouraging people to use those bank accounts. The debate shifts to developing financial products that encourage people to use those bank accounts. So all of these databases are now coming together. The SECC, the Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana, Aadhaar biometry, spliced with direct benefit transfers, which is still in early stages because it has really been done so far, if you leave out fertilizer, it's really been done so far only for pensions and scholarships, and now a little bit for kerosene. What is the bottom line I want to leave you with? The bottom line I want to leave you with is that many of you are young. All the students certainly are young. Constantly one hears the refrain, India is a young country. There is a demographic dividend. India is not going to remain young indefinitely. Beyond the year 2035 or thereabouts, India is going to age. So we have a limited window. When I was a student and when I was a teacher, we used to think, we were taught, that there were the groups of developed countries in the world, the halves of the world, and there were the underdeveloped or the developing countries in the world, they were the have-nots. And it would take hundreds of years for the developing countries to catch up with the developed countries. Many countries have demonstrated you don't need to wait for generations, you don't need to wait for hundreds of years. Roughly around the year 1991, the IMF produced a table. In that table, the IMF asked, how many years will it take for a country like India to halve the gap between India's per capita income and that of the developed countries, average developed countries? The answer was 153 years. Despite increases in life expectancy, despite increases, improvements in health delivery, not a single person in this room is going to be alive for 153 years. We are not prepared to wait for the future. About India, it is often said that the past was glorious, the future is glorious, it is the present alone that is bleak. For the first time I see signs, do not demand that change happens. If you do not demand that by the year 2035, we get out of that 20% of poverty, that change is not going to happen. In the nature of my job, I travel quite a bit throughout India. And when I travel throughout India, I get the sense of a vibrant, pulsating, impatient, young India. A young India that was born after 1991, or a young India that grew up after 1991. I sense this throbbing, vibrant, pulsating young India that is impatient for that development, for that prosperity to happen. And you are the agents of that change. From the snow-capped mountains of the Himalayas to the turbulent shores of the ocean in Kanyakumari, from the arid, salty deserts of Gujarat to the lush green fields of Arunachal Pradesh, you are the ones who can change that India, not us. The future is yours for you to live in and for you to leave that as a legacy for posterity. Thank you very much.
questions from the audience?
Before we take a few questions from the audience, I'd really like to thank Vivek for speaking so energetically, straight from the heart, and conveying to you what very often we try to convey in class. Vivek, it was brilliant, and I could see the strong energy in it. One more announcement, I think I missed it. Not really an announcement, but appreciation. Before Vivek gave his talk, we had a little book releasing ceremony. And then, you know, many of you who do not belong to the School of Economics must be wondering what this was all about. A tribute to my two wonderful faculty, Ishita Ghoshal, Sushma Nayak, for painstakingly, you know, reading every article of what the students write, correct it, redraft, reframe, sitting on the computer continuously and getting exasperated with the students and the students getting exasperated with the teacher. Thank you for your contribution, and that's what comes out in those gray volumes, because when the students go out to give their biodatas for jobs, they are skilled enough to write reports, and that's what we really want to ensure. Not just being able to speak, but to be able to write and to be able to quantify and analyze. Thank you, all of you. And now for the question and answer
of change. If nothing else,
If someone had asked me 5 years ago, do you think there will ever be a private port in Kerala? I would have said no. So therefore, Kerala is also changing. One of the very desirable things that have happened as a result of the changes is that there's a great deal of competition among states. By the way, you'll find a very strong correlation between states playing football and not doing, or being interested in football and not doing that well on economic development.
Good morning, sir. I'm Shumadi Basu from Simla School of Economics. Sir, talking about economic reforms, has the significance of land reforms declined post-liberalization in India?
Explain what you mean by land reforms.
Sir, laws related to redistribution of lands to the mass who needs it.
Explain further.
Sir, I guess the lower section of people, they need the land more badly. If we take the example of Operation Barga in West Bengal, it was initiated by the state government. Sir, I would also like to know why there is such reluctance from the central government to initiate these reforms. In case of West Bengal, it was done by the then leftist government, and in case of Kerala, it was also done by the state government.
Good. So now, she says that the way I'm provoking you, I'm goading you, no one else will ask questions, but I will still continue to goad you. Have you read the Constitution of India?
No, sir.
Please do. In the Constitution of India, there is something called the Seventh Schedule. The Seventh Schedule sets out what is on the union government list, what is on the concurrent list, and what is on the state list. Where is land? Entirely on the state list. Which partly answers your question about why state governments are doing things and why the union government is not. Having said this, the reason I wanted you to explain is land means several different kinds of things, because there are a bundle of land rights. The fact of the matter is that, particularly if I'm talking about rural land, which is what you're hinting at, if I'm talking about rural land, there has been too much of fragmentation. About 85% of land holdings are less than 1 hectare. About 90% of land holdings are less than 2 hectares. There has been so much of fragmentation that land holding is suboptimal. I'm not talking about states like Punjab, Haryana, and western parts of UP where there was an attempt of consolidation. So people who earn a living on that land are at near subsistence levels. Therefore, we don't want so many people to earn a living from that fragmented land. We have too many people working on land. As part of the transformation of agriculture, what should happen is, increasingly there should be A, commercialization and diversification, B, commercialization and diversification not only within agriculture, but also into things like poultry. The reason I mentioned poultry is with 1 hectare of land, it may be inefficient for me to grow rice. But 1 hectare of land may be completely, may be enough for me to do poultry farming. We need to get people off the land. We need to ensure off-farm employment opportunities. Land, as I said, is a bundle of rights. There is an ownership issue. There is an issue of people who don't own the land but earn a living from the land. And Operation Barga was about people who don't own the land but earn a living from the land. It is also a fact that today in many parts of India, tenancy, which is separate from ownership, tenancy is illegal. If you make something illegal, you just drive it underground. It doesn't disappear. It just goes underground.
in the process of tenancy going underground, the tenant cannot use his land as collateral to get a loan from the bank. A tenant cannot do improvements on that land because the tenancy is not guaranteed. Land, therefore, is a whole bundle of rights. To equate it with what we equated it to in the 1950s, that is only about ownership and about redistribution, is fallacious.
Sir, good morning, sir. Good morning, ma'am. I'm Nessie from Banking and Finance. Even I'm student of ma'am. I was with. So my question is, first of all, I just would like to know what was in since 1945 to 19. What are economic reforms or what are changes we have seen so far, almost from 1990s. So I just would like to know what was in since 1947 to 1990s when all the economic reforms took place. And my second question is.
Let me understand that. 47 to 91, what significant reforms took place? Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, I mean, mostly the reforms took place after 1990. So what was India since all this period time, almost 43 years? And my second question is like the gap, the measurable the gap between the poor and rich. And even Dr. Rajan, who was trying to control the inflation, which mostly is also one is about the gap between the poorest and the richest. So this problem also is long time India is lacking. So what are the solutions then?
Let me respond to the first. And again, I mentioned in passing that when the World Bank churns out poverty estimates today, those poverty estimates, the origin of those poverty estimates actually are work done in India. In 1991, people got very agitated when they said, aha, we are doing these reforms because of what the World Bank told us. If you look at the reform blueprint in 1991, and you contrast it with a committee in 1978 known as the Dagley Committee, you will find that everything that the World Bank said that India should do in 1991 was there in the Dagley Committee in 1978. The jargon was a little bit different. But to answer the question of between 47 and 91, in 1991, I'm not talking about what happened after 1991. In 1991, it was about external sector reforms, very substantive external sector reforms and industrial de-licensing. That's it, in 1991. External sector meaning export subsidies, import licensing, tariffs, exchange rates, FDI. FII came a little bit later. Between 47 and 91, reforms thus defined, and by the way, we need to define reforms. And the best definition of reforms actually is what should the government do and what should the government not do. Between 47 and 91, there were only two episodes of reforms thus defined, both pertaining to the external sector, both essentially on the import regime. Not so much tariffs, more the quantitative restrictions of imports. The first one was around 76, 75, 76. I forget the exact year. This was when the Prime Minister was Indira Gandhi. And the second one was around 85, 86 when Rajiv Gandhi was the Prime Minister. So those reforms, those early episodes of reforms, were certainly not as comprehensive as what has happened in 1970, 1991 and thereafter. They were restricted to the import regime on the gap between the poor and the rich. I'm wondering how to answer this without using a graph or something like that. So let me put it like this. Suppose I look at the bottom 20% of the population. I look at the top 20% of the population and there is the 60% in between. And if I track what has happened since 1991, and I'm tracking this at an all-India level, remember I told you about the inter-regional differences. The story is the following. The top 20% has gained, absolute terms as well as relatively. The bottom 20% has also gained, absolutely as well as relatively. The bottom 20% may not have gained as much as the top 20%, but the bottom 20% has also gained. The squeezing in relative terms, not absolute, has been for the chunk in the middle. So, rich poor, that's not the right expression to use, because I need to define what is the poor and I need to define what is the rich. But the squeezing in terms of the shape of the curve in relative terms has been in the middle, not the top, not the bottom.
Good morning, sir and ma'am. I am Neha. And my question to you is that currently the Gini coefficient for urban India is 0.34 as stated by you earlier, and the rural area, the Gini coefficient is 0.32. So my question is that in spite of the lot of difference in the opportunity of access opportunity being different in villages as well as in the rural, in the urban area, how come there is such a narrow gap between the Gini coefficient? As in, one would expect probably the Gini coefficient to be a little higher than 0.34 for the urban area and a little below 0.32 for the rural area. So basically my question is, how come there's such a the magnitude of difference between the Gini coefficient is so low, because the opportunities in both the areas are differing?
Very good question. But remember, those figures I gave you are for all India. There are significant regional variations. What do you think is the average population size in the village? Take a guess.
Probably 10,000.
Any other suggestions? 5,000. You see, rural, urban, village, city, these are census terms. We use them all the time. But you must realize that they can also be somewhat misleading. I mentioned 150,000 villages that are deprived. There are 100,000 villages in India that have population sizes less than 500. There are around 50,000 villages that have population sizes less than 200. And the challenge of delivering the kinds of things that I talked about, the roads, the water, the electricity, whatever, is really primarily for those villages that have population sizes that are less than 200 and less than 500. Those are the difficult ones. They're sometimes on difficult terrain also. When I ask the question, what is the average population size in a village? 5,000. I'll accept that, because one of the definitions of becoming urban is when the population size crosses 5,000. But you will be surprised to know that there are villages in India that have population sizes of 50,000. There are two villages in Maharashtra which have population sizes of 70,000, but they're still a village. You may be surprised to know that there are 237 villages inside Delhi. They are still villages. What is the point I'm making? Look at it. Think of it in the following terms. Before the reform started, about 100,000 villages were already integrated into the mainstream. The villages in Delhi. as a process of the reforms, another 250,000 villages have now become integrated. If I travel in Kerala, if I travel in Punjab, I no longer know when the town ends and when the village begins. There are those 100,000 villages that are still deprived. Now, just conceptually, what do you think is happening to inequality? Inequality between the 250,000 which have got integrated and the 100,000 which are still marginalized has actually increased. Do you see what I mean? Is that a good thing or is it a bad thing? It's probably a good thing because the radius of development is, so to speak, expanding. So whenever you look at an aggregate figure, that is slightly misleading. And in parts of rural India, which have become integrated and are becoming integrated, the Gini coefficient actually has gone up. It is approaching the 0.4 kind of mark. Also, these Gini coefficient numbers that I gave you, they came from what? I hinted at it, the NSS. The last NSS is still 2011-12. Some, all the data that I gave you, whether it's poverty, Gini coefficient, it's 2011.
May I request you to keep the questions precise? Thank you.
Good morning, sir. I'm Amlan from SSC. And my question is, in order to create an enabling environment for better growth and governance, are smaller states an answer? And I would really like your views on the future of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh.
Essentially, what is a government trying to do? A government is trying to do what most of us economists would call deliver public goods and services. There is an optimal level at which you can deliver these public goods and services efficiently. Above that, diseconomies of scale and scope set in. Below that, also diseconomies of scale and scope set in. It is patently obvious on grounds of economic rationale that some states are simply too large to govern satisfactorily. Uttar Pradesh being an obvious example. It is also patently obvious that some states are too small to govern efficiently. Now, if there's anyone from the press, please do not misquote. It is patently obvious that a state like Meghalaya, a state like Manipur, a state like Nagaland is too small to govern efficiently and optimally deliver public goods and services. Unfortunately, it is the case that state formation in India has never been done on grounds of economic rationale. It has been done when the first state reorganization commission was set up, when was that, 1956, on linguistic grounds, which is a bad way to create a state. The recent state formation, whether it is Telangana, Andhra, whether it is Bihar, Jharkhand, UP, Uttarakhand, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, all of these have also not been done on grounds of economic rationale. If one were to look at India and try to figure out purely on grounds of economic rationale how many states there should be, you would probably come up with a figure of around 50. Purely on grounds of economic rationale. I personally think that it is high time we had a second state reorganization commission which looked at state formation with rationale and objective grounds. I do not think the Telangana-Andhra separation was the
very efficiently done, even assuming that the separation was to be done. Hyderabad being a case in point. But you also asked a pointed question about whether smaller states do better. And we just have three empirical instances recently. Long back it was Punjab, Haryana, Maharashtra, Gujarat. Recently we just have three. We have Bihar, Jharkhand. We have Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and we have UP, Uttarakhand. There are always dangers in correlating with one particular event. But if you just do the correlation, after the state formation, not only has the smaller state begun to perform better, the bigger state has also begun to perform better.
Morning, sir. I'm Girish from SITM. I have a question that with the increase of FDI in different sectors and opening up of Indian market to global world, so are we not weakening or reducing the possibility of Indian growing company to become a global MNC?
To become?
A global multinational company or global MNC?
Is there a Haldiram in Pune? But have you heard of Haldiram? What was Haldiram like 15 years ago? Did you go to Haldiram 15 years ago? And do you see a remarkable transformation in Haldiram?
Yes, sir.
Yes, you do. So what the competition does, the color of the competition doesn't matter, whether it is foreign or domestic, what competition does is it allows companies, it exerts the pressure on companies to improve, right? So therefore, I see no particular reason why we should feel as companies, why you should feel threatened. There will always be companies that will close down, but there will always be companies that will prosper. Competition is about entry as well as exit. Both happen simultaneously. I don't know if you know that there are more, well, pre-Brexit, post-Brexit, we don't know what's going to happen. There are more Indian investments in Britain, FDI, than British investments in India.
Yes, sir.
Depends on the definition of an MNC. What is the definition of an MNC? If I interpret an MNC as a company that has subsidiaries in more than one country, there are already Indian MNCs. And with the competition, you'd expect many more Indian MNCs to happen. Is Symbiosis abroad? Well, Symbiosis, defined in those terms, Symbiosis will become an MNC. SPG an MNC.
We'll have the last question for the day.
Sure. Good morning. Sir, I have one question. Where will you see India within the coming 15 years among the region country from economic perspectives? Where will you see India among the regional countries from economic perspectives within the 15 years? Did you get it? Sir? Where will you see India within 15 years among the regional countries from economic perspectives?
No, I heard you. It's not that I didn't hear you, I didn't understand you. What do you mean by among the regional countries?
Yeah, original countries.
No, but what does that mean?
Because as we know, India has a huge or great population. So if you compare India with Chinese and also some other countries, regional countries, what will happen to Indian economic after 15 years, coming 15 years, future 15 years?
I didn't understand what you meant by among the regional countries.
Yeah, because if you can't, you can compare with Chinese income.
You see, look. There is a lot of global uncertainty now because of Brexit and the consequences of Brexit. no one yet has been able to figure out what is going to happen as a result of that. But the broad story, which I guess answers your question in a way, is that the Indian growth rate is gradually inching up. Despite what is happening globally, there is enough of slack and plenty of endogenous sources of growth for the Indian growth rate to inch up to 8.9%, 8.5% or 9%. So the Indian growth will be about 8.5%, 9%. The Chinese rate of growth has begun to slow down. There are all kinds of questions being asked about the quality of Chinese statistics. Let me not get into that. Assuming the Chinese statistics are correct, then the Chinese rate of growth should stabilize at around 6.5%, around that. So you'll have India growing at 8.5%, you'll have China growing at about 6.5%. But there is a significant gap between India and China. Whatever be the indicator you use, including that of per capita incomes. So even if in India grows at 8.5%, by the year 2030, India will still not be able to reach the kind of per capita income that China has today.
We have time for one last question.
Hello, sir. Actually, I wanted to know about the behavior of poor, which was brought forward by poor economics, which was like how poor people behave is if they are given goods like they can spend money on nutritional goods, and instead of that there was two examples given that if they have a 10 rupees, they spend on banana instead of that they try to eat a pani puri. So what do you think the government can do about this behavior of the poor which has been shown?
Why should the government do anything? It is their choice, right? It is their choice. To give an example, direct benefit transfer, the money that has gone in, has it been used for buying LPG cylinders? No. The limited evidence we have is they've used it to top up their mobiles. Their choice. The moment you say that the government should do something, you essentially reveal what I call the planning commission mindset, which is sitting there in Delhi and trying to determine people's lives. If you empower people, they know what is best. Why should I decide for them?
Thank you so much, sir. So, I would inch towards the end of the program. I would like to, of course, thank our speaker, Dr. Vivek Deb Roy, for having taken out time from his extremely busy schedule. Dr. Jyoti Chandiramani, Director of SSE, for having constituted the memorial lecture so that we get to have this kind of a lecture today. The staff team who have worked tirelessly to put together this day, Dr. Shuchi Mishra, Devanshi, Urvashi, Shilpi, Sonali, we really appreciate the kind of support you've given all of us. The wonderful audience, of course, for being so patient and posing such pertinent questions. And of course, the students, staff, and faculty of SIU, without again whose support we wouldn't have seen this day. Thank you so much.